Hello friends, welcome to my channel and explore the world of Microsoft Azure. My name is Rajneesh Kaushik and I'm a Microsoft Certified Trainer, Consultant and an Enterprise Architect. For more latest videos and blogs, you can always log into my website rajneeshkaushik.com and subscribe to my blog. Please do not forget to subscribe my channel and click the bell icon so you don't miss the latest videos. Do like, share and comment. In this demo, we will learn how to deploy SQL Server Always On Availability Group on Azure Kubernetes Services or AKS. So here is the agenda. We will understand what is SQL Server Always On Availability Group, data synchronization options it provides, and how availability groups really works. Then we will understand Kubernetes and SQL Server Availability Group architecture, and then why it is important to use Kubernetes for always on feature of SQL Server. Then we will understand the demo solution created for this session and how this demo works. We will show that in the demo. What is SQL Server Always On Availability Group? It supports database level protection. In case of database level failures, your application can still continue to work without any business interruptions. How does it work? It has two different replicas. One is primary replica and then second is secondary replicas. There can be 1 to 8 secondary replicas and 3 primary replicas. These primary and secondary replicas can be synchronized with two options. First is asynchronous data movement and second is synchronous data movement. It also provides encrypted data stream for the highest security. And whenever you want to fail to the another instance, you can do it either automatically or manually. SQL Server Always On Availability Group provides the capability to group two or more databases which perform a failover as a single logical unit. It supports at least one single primary replica, which is used to read and write the databases, and then 1 to 8 secondary replicas. And each of these databases can be read-only databases. And these are the databases which serve as a purpose of potential failover targets for the overall availability groups. Availability group databases are actually failed together as a unit. Okay, so they always fail together as a unit, and it provides the synchronous and asynchronous replicas. And it helps you to be redundancy. It helps you to implement the redundancy only at the database level. The primary replica makes the primary database available for the read-write connection from the client so that the client can still work on the primary replica, reading and writing the data. And this primary replica sends the transaction logs to the of the primary database to the secondary database. So the secondary database can replicate the transaction happening on the primary databases. And we will look into it in the next slides. Now, each secondary replica actually caches the transaction log, which is coming from the primary replica, and applies it onto the secondary databases. Now, the data synchronization happens between the primary and the secondary databases, and which happens independently of each other. So in this case, if secondary database is suspended or failed, it does not impact the other secondary database. And the primary database can also be suspended or failing without affecting any other primary databases. SQL Always On provides two data synchronization options, synchronous and asynchronous. In synchronous data synchronization, this provides the zero data loss, but at the same time, we have some overhead of increased transaction latency. How synchronous option works is whenever a data is committed at the primary level, at the same time, all the secondary replicas synchronize this transaction. And the moment the secondary replicas synchronize it, then only it is committed to the primary. So it has the zero data loss, but at the same time, it has to wait for the secondary replicas to commit it. And that is why it has some increased transaction latency. In case of asynchronous, there is no guarantee of zero data loss, and because the log records for the transaction may arrive a little bit later. So in asynchronous option, the secondaries are hardened asynchronously. And the biggest advantage of asynchronous is that the primary replicas don't have to wait for the confirmation from the secondary replicas for the transaction. But at the same time, the disadvantage is that the secondary replica can be lagging behind the primary. Let's understand these synchronization options in the next slide. How availability groups really works. So whenever a user try to access the replica and then there is a transaction committed, how it works in the both the synchronization options. So first let's understand the synchronous commit. So the moment the transaction is committed on the primary replica, there is a transaction log which is sent to the secondary replica. And once this transaction log is executed on the secondary replica, then there is a confirmation received to the primary replica. And then at that point of time, the transaction is really committed. That is why there is a transaction latency in the synchronous commit. Now let's understand the asynchronous commit. In the asynchronous commit, the transaction logs are sent to the secondary replica and primary replica does not really wait till the time the secondary replica is updated. So that is why it provides you a faster response time. Kubernetes and SQL Server Availability Group Architecture. So in this architecture, these nodes are serviced by load balancing service. So whenever a user try to access it, it is always accessed via the load balancing service. Every node has the pods which is running these SQL Server containers. And these nodes are connected to the persistent volume claim and persistent volumes, which is nothing but a Azure disk. All the communication happening to the network from outside network is happening via the load balancing service. And then this external storage is nothing but the Azure disk. Okay, so why it is important to use Kubernetes for SQL always on availability? Because first of all, we don't have to set up a Windows failover clustering in case we are setting up in the Windows environment, or if you are setting up in the Linux environment, you don't have to set up a Linux pacemaker cluster. So that simplifies our deployment. Then another capability is that Kubernetes is orchestration engine. It provides automatic failover capability. So you don't have to worry about how the failover will happen in case of non-Kubernetes environment. And finally, you can spin up 17 distributed replicas, which is a large number. Now let's understand our demo solution details. In this solution, we have deployed a 3-node Kubernetes cluster with 3 storage volumes. We have used SQL 2019 availability groups. In this group, we have 1 primary replica and 2 secondary replica. In these 2 secondary replicas, one of them is synchronized and another one is synchronized with the asynchronous option. And in this solution, the Kubernetes replica set is actually protecting the pods from all the failures. And in the availability groups actually replicates this transaction log from primary replica to the secondary replica. So let's understand the replica configuration, which is nothing but a YML file. In this file, we have created the 3 replicas exactly same way. So I'm just showing you one replica so that you understand this concept. So in this, this is a primary replica, which is labeled as MS SQL primary. This shows the container name, which is a RHEL SQL Server 2019 latest container. And there is this environment variable, which has a SA password for SQL Server. And along with that, it also have the MS SQL enable HADR option. So these are the options which we have set up. And this password is stored in the Kubernetes secret. We have also created the volumes. So in this case, the volume is MS SQL DB volume. And the volume claim name is MS SQL primary. And this is going to be changed for the secondary replicas with the MS SQL secondary 1. And MS SQL secondary 2. And here is a detail about the load balancing service. And this load balancing service actually uses the 1433 port for SQL Server and 5022 port for the inner communication of this availability group replicas. Now let's understand how we have done the storage class and persistent volume claim in the YML configuration file. So in this, there is this storage class. The storage class is using persistent volume claim for primary replica and persistent volume claim for replica one, which is a secondary replica. And then there is another one for the secondary replica two. Actually, internally it uses SU disk, and it also have the access mode of read write once for all these three persistent volumes. Let's understand the steps followed in the demo. First, we will log into the Azure with the Azure CLI. Then we will create a resource group. In this resource group, we will create all of our resources. Then in that resource group, we are going to create three node cluster, and then we are going to get the credentials of the cluster so that we can start connecting to that cluster. We will list the nodes to verify that if cluster is successfully created or not. And then we will create a load balancing service. Once the load balancing service is created, then we will create the external storage with persistent volume and persistent volume claim. And then we will list the persistent volume and persistent volume claim to ensure that these are successfully created. And finally, we will create a secret to store the SQL Server SA password. And then we will deploy primary and secondary replicas with the YML file. Once these replicas are deployed, then we will execute a SQL command on the primary replica, which will create a certificate on the primary replica. And then we will copy this certificate from the primary replica to our local host and from local host to the two secondary replicas. Now our SQL Server is ready. And now what we will do, we will check that whether the availability group is working fine. And what we will see is that on the primary replica, whatever database we have created, the same database is created in the secondary replicas. Then what we will do, we will insert a couple of records on the primary replica, and then we will check on the secondary replicas whether those records are updated there or not. So this will conclude that our SQL Server Always availability group is working fine. Now what we will do, we will perform a testing. So in this testing, we will perform a failover testing. In this case, we will delete the primary pod and check if that primary pod is automatically created. So within 3 seconds, you will see that the primary pod is automatically created and it is up and running without impacting your solution. And then we will discuss some troubleshooting tips in case if you set up this in your environment, then you can use this troubleshooting tips. Okay, so let's get started with the demo. We are using Visual Studio Code for this demo. And the first step is that we are going to log into the portal with the EZ login CLI command. I've already logged into the portal with the CLI command, so I'm not going to execute it. Now let's go to the second step. I'm going to create a resource group RG SQL AG. It's created, and then we are going to use the AZ AKS create to create a 3-node cluster, and the cluster name will be SQL AG, and it's going to use standard B2MS VM size. Okay, so now the cluster is created. Let's get the credential for the cluster so that we can connect. Because since I have already created it, so it's asking me to override it. I will say yes. Now we will list the nodes whether it is successfully created. Yes, it is. We will get the pods. There is no pod because we are going to create that pods inside it. Now we just created a node. So this command is not going to work. Now we are going to create the PV and PVC persistent volume and persistent volume claim. And in this, we are going to use SQL AG storage YAML file, which we discussed already. This file is here. This created this persistent volume and persistent volume claim with MS SQL primary, MS SQL secondary one, and MS SQL secondary two. So that is done. Now we will check whether the persistent volume is created or not with the getPV command. Yes, this is created and it is bound. We are also checking whether the persistent volume claim is done. Yes, it is also created. Now we are going to create the secret, and this secret will be SA password. That is a super admin password for SQL Server. And this password, we want to store it in the Kubernetes secret. So this is created. Now we will use the kubectl apply command to deploy these three replicas, one primary and two secondary replicas. So primary is done. Secondary replica is also done. And then another secondary replica is also done. Now we will see what is the status of these nodes, ports, and services with the get all command. Now we can see that this is still being created, so it is pending. And this is containers are getting created, so that is why the status is container creating. And then it is going to assign the IP addresses once it is created. And if we see this here, we go to the resource group and then we go to this Kubernetes cluster and see our services. It is created successfully now. So if you run this command again, it will not show container creating. It will say that it is created. Okay, still getting created. And container creating option is also visible here. It is also saying that these three deployments are still getting created. That's why it is showing this symbol. Let's again try get pods command, whether this is created. Yes, so first one is created, that is why it is showing running, but other two still getting created. And if you see the same status by refreshing it, it just now shows that all of them are created successfully. And let's again run this command. It is running now. Okay, good. So now let's move to the next step. So in this, we are going to retrieve the IP addresses of these three replicas. And these are the IP addresses. We are going to take this IP address and use SQL Server Management Studio to log into these three IP addresses. Okay, so we already noted down the IP address of first replica. We already know the password. Let's try connecting to it. It is successfully created. Now we will connect to the second replica, which is this IP address. Now we are using another IP address. So the second replica is also created. Now let's see the IP address of third one. So now it shows that all three replicas are already created. So now let's go to the next step. And the next step is now create a certificates on the primary replica and then copy that certificate from primary to the local and then from local to the secondary replicas. So we will open the SQL Management Studio and then open the file. And this is a create primary AG file which we will use. So let's understand this, what we are trying to achieve in this. First, we are going to create a SQL test AG database. Then we are going to create a table called customer table and then put these three values. And then we will put the recovery set to full. These are the steps used for always on high availability. And then we will backup the database. We'll create the logins with the password and then we will create a certificate and this certificate name will be agcertificate.cert and then we will use this certificate key ag_certificate.key and then this is a password for encryption. Then we'll create a availability group endpoint so that the other replicas can communicate via this endpoint. The port which we are going to use for this endpoint is 5022 port. And then we will create the availability group for the primary. And we are going to set the configuration for primary, which is a synchronous commit automatically because it is a primary. Then another secondary one is again synchronous commit. And then third one is a synchronous commit. And then we will add the database to the availability group. So let's run this command. And the moment we run this command, we will see that this database is getting created here. And always on high availability, you will see that this is a group which is already created. And it only shows the primary replica. These two replicas are still not created. So now we will go to the CLI and because now the certificate is already created, so we will copy the certificate to the local host and then from local host we will copy the certificate to the secondaries. So let's start with the setting the variables. First you will retry the pod name so that this pod name we can use in our next line of code. So this is working fine. Now we will create the variables and this variable will be used to copy the cert and cert key file to the local host and then from local host to the secondaries. So this is done. Now this command will work to copy to the local from the primary replica. And if you see here, these two files are getting created now. So that means it is copied to the local. Now this local file, we are going to copy to the first secondary. So this is copied. And then we are going to use the same for the secondary replica call. And this is also done. Now we will go to the SQL Server Management Studio and select the first secondary. And in this, we are going to open the file and do some configuration. So let's understand this as well. So this is a secondary AG. In this, we are going to create the login for the availability group and then we will use the same key because we are going to use the same encryption. So in this certificate which we have created on the primary, we are going to use the same. So we need to use the same password and then we already imported the certificate, so which is already there, but we require a password to be added into the secondary. And then we will, as usual, we'll create the endpoints, which will listen to 5022 port and use the AG certificate. AG underscore to certificate, and then we will alter the availability group and we will use this command to finally make it secondary replica. So let's execute it. Now if you see, there is no database, but if you refresh it after the command is running, we will automate this primary replica database will automatically replicate to the secondary replica. So this command is still getting executed. Okay, it is done. Now you see this, it is synchronized with the primary, this one. Good. So now let's follow the same commands which we have followed for the secondary one on the secondary two. So let's open this, and now secondary AG, again same set of command. First we will create the AZ availability group login and use the same password which was used for creating the certificate, and then we'll use the availability group endpoint, and then you know finally we will execute this script. So this is executed, and if you see, there is nothing here on the database side, but if you refresh it and keep refreshing it, you will see that once this script is executed successfully, it will become the secondary replica 2. Okay. Yes, it is done. Now you can see that this is a secondary replica. So in these two databases, we have not explicitly created the files. We have not explicitly created a database, but because since it is synchronized from the primary, that is why all the tables are getting created and database is getting created. So if you see in this database, there is the table. This table is a customer table, and if we just use the select command, you will see that it has only three records. So what we will do now, we will add a couple of records into this table and then check whether the same records are getting propagated to the two different replicas. So now we are inserting these three values on the primary replica. Okay, so now let's see whether these values are created or not. Okay, we can see that this records are updated. Now you can see that initially there were only three records, but now it is six records. So now let's check the secondary replica, whether these records are propagated or not. So now let's go to table. And check. Yes, these records are updated on the first secondary replica. And now let's check it whether these are executed on the second replica or not. So now we can see that these records are propagated on the secondary replica as well. Now there are six records into it. So that means our replication is working successfully. Now let's go to the next step of the demo. In this, what we are going to do, we are going to delete the primary replica and see whether the primary replica is getting created or not. So here we are going to delete the first, get the name of the primary replica, and then we'll delete this pod. And after that, after 3 seconds of sleep time, we will again check the pod. So in our case, first we will run this command. So now it's deleting this, and the moment it deletes it, you will see that this database is becoming a little bit unresponsive. Okay, it's becoming unresponsive. But the moment it is done, it will again come back because Kubernetes will automatically recreate it. Okay, so now it's recreated. So we will see that if we again do the get pods command, you will see that these three pods are running, because initially this pod name was there. If you see now, when Kubernetes recreated it, it created with a different, little bit different name. So that is why this name is different than this initial one. And now these three replicas are working successfully. And now if you see, refresh it, you will see that this database came back and it has this table again. All these records, six records. So that means our testing is also done. Now, this completes our demo, but if you are trying to do perform this steps and if you face some issues, so I have added a couple of commands. And these commands can be very useful for your troubleshooting steps. So first is get all commands give you all the details about the replica set, deployment, and then, you know, service, and then IP addresses where your service is running, along with your you know, other details, with your pod details. This kubectl top nodes shows you the top executing nodes, which is consuming the memory. So this shows you the top nodes, and this shows your top pods from the resource users perspective. This command kubectl get service helps you to find the detail about the service. You can use this kubectl get. If you put a pod name here, you will be able to get the YML file used to deploy the pod. So in our case, our pod name was this pod name. So we will copy this, and if you paste it here and run it, it will display the YML file. Yeah, this is the file which we used initially. Now, if you want to dump the pod information, you can dump that as well. With you want to dump a very specific pod information instead of dumping everything, so you can use this command. So it only provides you the detail about that particular pod. It will also show you the errors, warnings. This can be very helpful for your debugging purpose if something is not working. It also provides you the event log, what event happened at what time, what was the name of the event. Then another command for describe deployment. This will describe the deployment detail. So what are the deployments which is available, and their detail about all the deployments. This is again going to be used to describe a pod with their application name. So, okay, so this is describing that with the application name. Okay. This describes you PV and PVC. We already used it to find the persistent volume and persistent volume claim. This is used for finding out the logs coming from the application. So this shows you all the SQL Server logs. Okay, see, I have used a wrong app name. That's why it is not showing. So let me correct it. Now it will run successfully. Yes, it shows you all the logs. You can use this command for all the events sorted with the timestamp. So this will sort all the events with the timestamp. And you can also find the events based for the particular pod. So this is for the pod level events. And if you forget your secret value, what you have put for the SA password, and you want to know that, this command will be able to tell you that this was the password. This is used to retrieve the pod name, which we have already used in the earlier. So now it shows the pod name. If you echo the pod name, it will show you the pod name. This is a pod name. If you want to execute some command on the directly on the pod, you can use this with the interactive session. Yes, now this interactive session is running this command, top command, directly into the pod. You can also create a session inside the pod, which is interactive session, and then run your commands there. Okay, so I think I need to first come out of it. Okay, now I will run another command to put interactive session. Now I am inside the pod. Now I can use any command like ls or any other command. So let's come out of it and then run another command. Similarly, you can run the SQL Server command remotely with this kubectl exe it, and this command is used to execute anything interactively. So in this case, we are running this command, SQL cmd command, and we are running this select query on the directly on the SQL Server from here, and it will show you the result. Okay, so select. Okay, so looks like my password is wrong. Okay, now let's again try. Yeah, it worked fine. So that means this command is working perfectly fine. Okay. Now, if you want to browse the dashboard, we can use this command. You can use, without using this command also, you can browse it, because this particular command will take you to the portal.azure.com and open this. It will take you to the portal to see the workload information. So these commands you can use to troubleshoot your SQL Server deployment on Kubernetes. We can use these commands from SQL Server Management Studio to troubleshoot the issues of always on high availability. So let's discuss the first command, get roles and health. So once you run this command, it will give you the roles and their health. Then similarly, for the next command, get modes and endpoint, it will provide you that information about the replica server name, availability mode, that means what synchronization mode they are using, and their URL, endpoint URL. Similarly, if you go to retrieve the availability group databases and their state, this command will run and it will show you the availability group and their status, online status, their replica server name, synchronization status, their health, and other information like log set, queue size, and other things. Then if you go to retrieve, you execute this command, select name from sys availability groups, it will provide you the availability group name. And finally, if you run this command to retrieve the primary replica status, it will give you this outcome.
Thanks for watching, and do not forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon so you don't miss the